Hello again, students of high schools in Jamaica and the Caribbean. This is Derek Gillespie, and I welcome you once again to the Gillespie's online learning channel. This video is specifically created for students of third form who are being introduced to the subject geography at the CSEC level or the CXC level. CSEC, of course, abbreviation for Caribbean Secondary Examination Council. CXC, the old abbreviation for Caribbean Examination Council. So in this video, we're going to be looking at the Earth as a planet. And we want to look at four basic things that any geography student who is being introduced to geography or who intends to specialize in geography at the fourth and fifth form level later on. These are some basic things that all geography students should know about the Earth. And in this video, we want to explore four main things. First, we want to look at the location of the Earth. Where are we in the universe? We want to then look at the shape of the Earth. We want to look at the movements of the Earth and the effects of those movements on life on the planet. And finally, we want to look at the structure or how the Earth is made up. So let us delve now into this topic of the Earth as a planet. Very beautiful satellite picture of the Earth we're looking at on screen. And I am actually going to zoom in on Jamaica. There you see Jamaica, where this video is being broadcasted from, island in which I live. And as I was saying, the Earth is a really beautiful planet. And as far as we know, it's the only planet capable of supporting life as we know it. It is suitably designed for the support of plant and animal life. And of course, it is suitably the home in an environment for man. But where are we in the universe? What is the location of the Earth? So let's go now into the first of the subheadings for this video. Now, the Earth is located in a very vast universe. And it is so vast and so huge that distances within our universe have to be calculated by way of a unit called light years. That's what the scientists call the distance light travels within 1 year. And when you consider the fact that, calculated scientifically, light travels at a speed of 186,000 miles per second, then you can imagine how far a distance a light year would be. In other words, the distance that light would travel within 1 year. That's how vast the universe is. And so distances within the universe, the only unit that humans could come up with that reasonably capture the idea of how vast this universe is to use light years. Now, the Earth as a planet is located within what is called a galaxy. A galaxy. In other words, a massive group or cluster of stars numbering in the billions. Now, the galaxy in which we are located is called the Milky Way. When you look up at the sky at night and you see all the stars that you can see as far as your eye can see, you are looking up at stars within just one cluster of our galaxy called the Milky Way. Now, within this Milky Way in which we are located, We are located within a group of planets called the solar system. The solar system. Now, solar is a word which comes from the word sun. And so this is the sun system in which we're located. In other words, our own sun is the star around which our planets that we know of, or which are closest to us, these planets go around in an orbit around this sun, capital S-U-N. Now, when we say orbit or go around, we are thinking of the word revolving from the word revolution. And so each planet, including the Earth, orbits or goes around the sun, or our sun. And I say our sun because every star out there is considered a body, a celestial body, a body in space that is considered a star. So our sun is actually our own star around which our planets orbit or revolve. Now, the solar system consists of our sun, which, as I said earlier, is a star, and its eight planets which are orbiting or revolving around this sun once every planetary year. And I say planetary year because each planet takes either a longer or shorter time to go around the sun to create its own planetary year. On Earth here, of course, we know that our Earth goes around the sun or revolve or orbits the sun once every 365 and a quarter days, making what we call one planetary Earth year. Now, if you look at the diagram that is on screen, you will notice, and this is just a diagram because this is not exactly how it actually is in real life, but this is just to illustrate the orbits of the planets and the order in which they are away from the sun. So you will notice that the Earth is the third planet away from the sun. Let's look at a diagram which actually gives you all the names. So there we have Mercury, Venus, followed by Earth, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, and Pluto. Now, Pluto is a planet that has been debated over the years as to whether or not it's a real planet. In the past, a couple years ago, it was dropped out of the list of nine planets. And for a while, we were accepting that there were only eight planets. Now, the debate has started again among scientists who are reconsidering, now that they know more about Pluto, to put it back in the list of planets. And so we are sure of eight planets, Mercury all the way out to Neptune. As you can see in the diagram, Pluto is still debatable as to whether or not it's a planet. But the Earth is the third planet away from the sun, and it would be advisable that you pause the video so you can study the sequence of the planets in their order from sun outwards to Neptune or Pluto. Now, the Earth, as it is among the planets orbiting the sun, is going around the sun in what is called an elliptical orbit. Elliptical. In other words, the orbit, the path that it takes around the sun is not fully circular. It's more like an oval-shaped kind of path or orbit. And so oval, in other words, almost like an egg shape. And so because of that, there are times in that orbit when the Earth will be pretty closer to the sun than normal. And at other times, it will be at its farthest point in that orbit. Now, when the sun is nearest, when the Earth rather is nearest to the sun in its elliptical or oval shaped orbit at a certain time of the year, that position is called its perihelion. Perihelion. And of course, as it continues to travel in its orbit around the sun, there's a time of year when the sun, the Earth, is at its farthest point from the sun in its orbit. And that position is called its aphelion. Perihelion, P-E-R-I-P-H-E-L-I-O-N. And aphelion, A-P-H-E-L-I-O-N. Now, in our solar system, the planets, they orbit the sun, as I said earlier, at different speeds. They go around or revolve the sun at different speeds and complete one revolution or one planetary year at different times. Some actually takes shorter time. Like Mercury, takes a shorter time to orbit the sun because it's closer, as you can see in the diagram. And of course, Pluto, Neptune, further away, would take a longer time. Mercury takes a shorter time as 88 days to go around the sun in one planetary year. And of course, the further away you go, it takes years, several years, for a planet to complete one revolution or one planetary year on that planet. Now, in our solar system, the nearest star to our sun, because remember I said that the sun is considered a star, it's a body of burning gases which self-supports itself in terms of burning to create energy and light. And so the sun is actually a star. The only reason why you don't see it in the night is simply because we are on the dark side of the Earth, which I'm coming to when we talk about the rotation of the Earth, when we look at the movements of the Earth. And of course, the sun is always shining, just like the stars out there in the sky, always shining. But the reason why we see stars at night, we are in the dark side at night. And the stars, which are always shining, even throughout the day, they become visible to our naked eyes, contrasted against the darkness. And of course, during the day, when we see the sun, the reason why we don't see the stars out there up in the sky when we look up is because our sun being so close to us, the brightness actually drowns out the light from the other stars that are out there, and we only see them at nighttime. The nearest galaxy to our Milky Way, in which we're located, is called the Andromeda Spiral Nebula. So we live within a galaxy called the Milky Way. The nearest one to us is, or the nearest other cluster of billions and billions of stars, is called the Andromeda Spiral Nebula. And of course, within our own Milky Way, our sun is actually the star which is the center of our solar system. But the closest star to our sun is called the Proxima Centauri. Mars, of course, is the nearest planet to the Earth within our solar system. And our moon is the nearest natural object in space to our planet. In fact, the moon goes around the Earth, orbits or revolves around the Earth just the same way that our Earth itself is going around the sun once every year. So the moon actually goes around the Earth once every month in a 28-day cycle doing its own orbit. I think that says enough on as it concerns the location of the Earth. Now let's move to the shape of the Earth. And this is an interesting topic because presently we have so many persons in the world who have been misguided by the internet and conspiracy theories and all kinds of persons out there who lack the ability to reason, or who have been misguided and duped by false information, who think that the earth is flat. We have come a very long way from that kind of misinformation. And so let me share with you once again what the facts are. Now, the earth, like all the other planets, is ball-like. It's like you have a basketball and you blow it up to full capacity. That is what the earth is like. The proper word for that is a spherical object. And the earth is therefore a sphere. Now, because the earth is a particular type of shape, yes, it is spherical, yes, it is ball-like, but interestingly, because of the earth's revolution around the sun, traveling at very high speeds each year around the sun, as well as the gravitational pull towards the center of the earth takes a particular shape where you can imagine a basketball that is blown up fully to capacity, fully spherical, but if you press slightly at the top and at the bottom of the basketball, you have a slight bulge around the middle and a slight flattening at the top and bottom. That's the kind of shape that the earth has. So, however, while the earth is spherical or ball-like, the best description of the earth's shape is one that is said to be geoid. G-E-O-I-D. Geoid. And like I said, while it is spherical around, all around, that is, it is circular on all its surfaces or edges, yet it is somewhat flattened, slightly flattened at the north and south pole, or at the top and bottom, and is slightly or lightly bulging around the middle, or at the region of what we would call the equator. Now, the shape of the earth being spherical, or more specifically, as you just learned, geoid, G-E-O-I-D, is proven easily in a number of ways. And we don't have to listen to all those conspiracy theories and the flat earth people who are misguided. There are some basic things which make us know that the earth is a sphere. And the first obvious thing is that if the earth was flat, as you're seeing the flat earth theory on screen illustrated, if the earth was flat, what that would mean is that the sun shining from above all places on the earth would literally have day and night at the same time. In fact, there would be no night, because the sun, which is constantly shining, would always be shining on the earth, and there would be no change from day to night. Everybody would have day at the same time. That's not the case. The second thing that we actually can be sure, or used to be sure, that the earth is a sphere or ball-like object is simply the technology of space travel. We have thousands, in fact, there are over 2,000 satellites circulating the earth every day, going in different directions, and all going around the earth in many directions. And in every single case that the satellites travel around the earth, so that we can have internet, so that we can share global TV, so that we can study the climate and all of that. Every satellite traveling in any direction around the earth, 2,000 of them on a daily basis, every picture they take of the earth shows a ball-like object. The only answer to that is that the earth is a sphere. That's the only object that you get any direction you go around it and take a picture, you get a ball or a circle. That has to be a sphere. And of course, when we consider how the seasons occur, some places have winter, while other places are having summer, while other places are having spring. For that to occur on the earth at the same time throughout the same year, earth has to be a sphere. Now, the earth as a planet, it travels on its axis, or it spins from left to right, or rotates, creating a change from day and night on a 24-hour basis. And every single day you get up and you see night change to day. And every month when you notice a change in the seasons, you know that the earth is a sphere because of these realities. Now, of course, we have learned of Christopher Columbus, who on his travel from Spain towards the West, proved that the earth is a sphere because he never fell off the edge anywhere. After Columbus proved that the earth is a sphere by traveling from west, or traveling west rather, in order to go east, another European, Ferdinand Magellan from Portugal, was the first human to fully, what we call, circumnavigate the earth by ship. So he traveled from Europe between 1522 and 1524, and he made a complete trip around the earth by sea and arrived back in Europe without falling off the edge. Of course, these are just some basic proofs that the earth is a sphere. But if you wish, you can go online and simply Google proofs that the earth is a sphere, and you can easily see why the flat earthers are misguided. Now let's move to the next subheading, and that's the movements of the earth. Now, the earth carries out two movements on its own at the same time or simultaneously. The first movement we spoke about earlier, where the earth goes around the sun every year, as you can see on the diagram. And of course, the second movement that the earth carries out is one where it spins on an imaginary axis. Now in this diagram, you're seeing a line of symmetry. Notice the line from the North Pole down to the South Pole running through the center of the earth. It's not a literal line. It's an imaginary line, but around that imaginary center, all satellites that have been out there in space taking pictures and photos and videos of the earth right throughout the year, that is what we notice that is happening. The earth is spinning from left to right. Notice the arrows from left, or the western side of the screen, to right, or the eastern side of the screen. The earth rotates. Let me go back to that original video that we looked at earlier, and you'll see what I'm talking about. This is actually a delayed photo capture of the earth spinning on its axis in 24 hours. In other words, the satellite out there videotapes the earth every second, and that picture is then speeded up, and this is what we see. The earth is spinning on its axis from left to right, or from west to east. Now, that movement is what is called rotation. The earth going around the sun from the start of the year to the end of the year until it completes one calendar year, 365 and a quarter days, is what is called revolution. So like I said, the earth carries out two movements on its own at the same time or simultaneously. In other words, while the earth is going around the sun, it is also rotating on its axis. The earth rotates or spins on its axis in an anti-clockwise. So this left to right spinning motion is what is called an anti-clockwise movement, as we saw in the earlier video. That is an anti-clockwise movement. In other words, if you are above the earth looking down from the North Pole, the earth is spinning in the opposite direction to what the clock, the hands on the clock would read from 12, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The earth is actually spinning in the opposite direction. So it would be 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, and so forth. This is what is called the anti-clockwise spin, or from left to right, or from west to east. So as I was saying, the Earth rotates on or spins on its axis in an anti-clockwise direction, and it completes this in 24 hours. It's actually 23 hours and 57 minutes, which has been rounded off to 24 hours, which we call an Earth day. And it is this motion which produces the gradual change from daytime to nighttime. And it is very simple. When we look at the diagram of the Earth going around the Sun, if you look closely at these diagrams, you can see that the side of the Earth that is facing the Sun is always in light. Look closely at the diagram, that is what you see. The side that is away from the Sun is always in darkness. So what happens is that the Earth simply rotates from the dark side to the light side so that there can be a change of night to day and day to night. This is what is called rotation. Now, while this rotation is taking place, the Earth also goes completely around the Sun in, remember the word we said earlier, in an elliptically, E-L-L-I-P-T-I-C-A-L, an elliptical or oval-shaped orbit, an orbit that is kind of egg-shaped, so it's not a perfectly circular path or orbit or revolution around the Sun. So you look at the diagram, and that is what you see. This movement around the Sun, as we said, takes 365 and a quarter days, which is what is literally called an Earth year. Now we know that we don't have any quarter day, so all that the calendar people have done is they put aside that quarter day for 4 years, and then after the 4 years they add it back to the calendar, and that is why we end up with what is called a leap year every 4 years. So every 4 years the calendar will have 366 days instead of 365, simply because of the additional the adding of those quarter days to create an additional day for the calendar. Now it is this movement of the Earth around the Sun once every year that causes a change in our calendar year, and as well as it is what produces the seasons. Now if you notice in the diagram, the Earth, look at the diagram of the Earth, in each stage as it travels around the Sun each year, you will notice that the Earth is tilted on its axis. Notice that it continues to rotate to produce day and night, but at the same time, as it goes around the Sun as a body, it is tilted at an angle of 23.5 degrees. Now it is this tilt which causes different parts of the Earth to be exposed to different amount of sunshine or sunlight throughout the year. And as the positions of the Earth change, either tilted away from the Sun, as you can see in the diagram on the right of the screen, or tilted towards the Sun, as you can see in the diagram towards the left of the screen. So as the position of the Earth changes in that tilt, as it goes around the Sun, it causes a change in light exposure, hitting different parts of the Earth, either in greater quantity or in lesser quantity. And so that is what that amount of light exposure and heat exposure throughout the year, as the Sun travels around, as the Earth rather, travels around the Sun, we end up with our seasons. Now, this is another proof that the Earth is a sphere and not flat, because if the Earth was flat, it would mean that all places would have the same season throughout the year. There'd be no change. And so because of the shape of the earth, and because of the tilt of the earth on its axis, and as it travels around the sun, it changes the position of that tilt or exposure of the surface to degrees of sunlight, you end up in the change of seasons: winter, summer, autumn, spring. These are the two movements of the earth and their effects on life on the planet. Now let us close off this presentation by looking at the final subheading in this video, and that is the structure of the earth. Now, the word structure simply means the way the various parts of an object are arranged and fitted together to make up the whole. The earth as an object consists of three states of matter: solid, liquid, and gas. And all these parts, whether they be solid, liquid, or gas, being arranged in a certain way to produce the whole, in other words, the whole planet as we know it, the way these gaseous, solid, and liquid parts fit together is called the structure of the earth. Now on screen, you can see a very simplified version of the earth structure, and we're looking particularly at the solid parts of the earth here. And there we can see the outermost shell of the earth, the land on which we live, is called the crust. Proper name for the crust is the lithosphere. Then we have the mantle below that. Then we have the core, divided into two regions, the outer and the inner core. So if you imaginatively take a slice out of the earth, this is what it would be like. So we have the water body, which is above the solid earth or the solid crust on which we live. And below that we have the mantle. Then we have the outer core and the inner core. So we're looking at what is called the structure of the earth. Now, I want to take it beyond the solid parts of the structure. And let's talk now about the gaseous part. The first or the outermost layer of gases which surround the earth. Scientists tell us that for approximately 300 miles above the surface, we have what is called the atmosphere. The outermost layer of gases, example, water vapor, oxygen, nitrogen, ozone, carbon dioxide, and many other gases, collectively create this outer band of or layer of gases called the atmosphere, which is approximately over 300 miles thick. This surrounding body of air is held in place, of course, by the pull of gravity so that it doesn't drift off into space. So gravity keeps our atmosphere trapped to the earth. Without those gases, we certainly would not survive. The surrounding body of air is held in place by the pull of gravity, as I said, and is crucial to the support of life on the planet. Now, that's the gaseous layer which surrounds us. And of course, we also know that the earth is filled with water. On the surface of the earth is an abundant supply of water, mainly in liquid form. You notice I did not say only, because water can be stored as ice, and it can also be in the form of water vapor as gas in the air. So on the surface of the earth is an abundant supply of water, mainly in liquid form, but can also be stored as solid ice, as snow, and even as water vapor floating in the air, forming clouds and fog and mist. Now, all the water bodies surrounding the earth, whether it be oceans or seas or rivers or lakes or ponds, even water that is inside the earth, underground, all of this water collectively forms another layer in the earth structure called the hydrosphere. H-Y-D-R-O-S-P-H-E-R-E, hydrosphere. And you notice the words atmosphere Atmos, related to gas or gases. Hydros, related to water. So all of the water bodies surrounding the earth together are called the hydrosphere. All of the gases surrounding the earth are called the atmosphere. And just as you notice, the word sphere is common to these words. When we come to the solid part of the earth, we also think of the lithosphere, the crust of the earth. Lithos, relating to rocks. So the covering of rocks all around, lithosphere. Just like the covering of water all around, hydrosphere. Just like the covering of gases all around, the atmosphere. Now the earth, with its abundant supply of water, forming the hydrosphere, is said to be over 70% of the earth's total surface. With, of course, rivers, lakes, swamps, adding to not just the sea and the ocean that we see when we look at a world map, but also on land, these water bodies. Let's now come to the solid part of the earth as we bring this video to a close. The solid part of the earth consists of an outer shell of rocks called the crust, or as we said earlier, the lithosphere. And below the crust inside the earth is a major middle layer called the mantle, as I showed you earlier. Now, this mantle has two layers. Upper layer, you're not seeing it in the diagram, but in upcoming lessons, we will look at the structure of the mantle in a little closer detail, and we will learn that the mantle consists of two layers, an upper layer and a lower layer, which will be very important in understanding certain aspects of geography later on. Keep that in mind as we go forward. Now, the outermost portion of the earth, or lithosphere, consists of solid rocks. So the crust itself consists of solid rocks, and it also has two layers. Upper layer, called the upper crust, and the technical term for that is sial, S-I-A-L. The upper crust, or the sial. Why is it called the sial? Because scientists consider that the upper crust consists of two main minerals, silicon and aluminium minerals, making up most of the rocks. And so they borrow the two letters of these names for the minerals. Silicon, they borrow the S-I. Aluminium, they borrow the A-L. And they combine these two together to remind us that the upper crust consists of mainly silicon and aluminium minerals. And of course, the lower crust is called the sima, from the two main minerals, silicon and magnesium. Same idea, borrowing the first two letters, they create these words, what are called acronyms. So the lower crust is called sima, S-I-M-A. And the upper crust is called sial, obviously from silicon and aluminium, main minerals in the rocks forming the upper crust. And the lower crust, the main minerals forming the rocks are silicon and magnesium. So I repeat, the solid part of the earth consists of an outer shell of rocks called the crust or lithosphere. And below the crust inside the earth is a major middle layer called the mantle. And this mantle has two layers, the upper and lower mantle. While the innermost portion of the solid earth is called the core, as you can see in the diagram. This core, scientists believe, is made up mainly of iron and nickel minerals. The outermost portion of the earth, or the lithosphere, consists of rocks and is divided into what is called the upper crust or sial, consisting mainly of silicon and aluminum minerals, hence the name Seal. And this upper crust is what forms the land on which we live. Islands, continents. And the lower crust, or SEMA, consisting mainly of silicon and magnesium minerals, hence the name SEMA. This lower crust forms the sea floors, so that's what is below the water in the ocean and seas. And this lower crust forms the base of the mountains and continents of the world. Now, in upcoming lessons, we will look at how the crust is further divided up into sections like jigsaw puzzle fitting together to form the outer shell of rocks. We will look at what are called plates of the world. So I won't spend much time in this video on that because that is coming up in an upcoming lesson or video. Now, the dividing boundary or line between the crust and the mantle, when you look at the diagram, look at the crust, look at the mantle, and that margin which is found between the two layers is considered to be the moho. It's called the moho for short, M-O-H-O. The dividing line or boundary between the crust and the mantle is called the moho. The technical term for it is named after the scientist who discovered it. It's called the mohorivichic discontinuity. But for short, we simply say the moho. Now, just below the crust and at the top of the mantle, remember we said that the mantle has two layers, upper and lower layer. Just below the crust at the top of the mantle, that is what is called the upper mantle, is an area of molten rock called the asthenosphere. A-S-T-H-E-N-O-S-P-H-E-R-E. Asthenosphere. Now, this is the area where scientists believe that molten rocks, which we know to be called magma, move slowly around, causing sections into which the crust are divided. These sections called plates, which we'll look at in an upcoming video. This movement of molten rock below the crust, in the upper part of the mantle, causes shifting of sections of the crust called plates to produce a phenomenon called plate tectonics. And we will come to that plate tectonics in the next video. Thank you for listening. I advise you to go through this video, make a list of the key technical words that you've learned about, do further research, go online, go to YouTube and watch more on this topic, and learn as much as you can about the Earth as a planet. Thank you for listening. Keep visiting to learn more about the wonderful Earth on which we live. Bye for now.